Coming, everybody. I'm going to keep this really short because we want to see the movie. And then afterwards, there'll be a conversation between all of us and Mr. Richard Roundtree, who is in the audience. We talked about this earlier. He's seen the movie more than once. And so Mr. Roundtree is going to go off and smoke a cigar while we're watching the movie, and then he's going to return for the Q&A. But I did want to say, as you know, that this was really one of the most significant movies of the early 1970s. It was released in 1971, and it did a couple of different things. It almost saved MGM by itself. MGM was in terrible trouble, and Shaft made much more money than anybody thought it would, and helped MGM stay in business. But you know, it introduced a new kind of African American character to them. African American characters had been stereotyped earlier as criminal or as stupid or as lazy, and then we got the very sort of pious African American character, like the Sidney Poitier characters. Who didn't have a blemish on them. But Shaft was something different, John Shaft. He was tough, he was smart, but he was also the hero. And that tough, smart, streetwise, swaggering hero, that was something that really hadn't been seen before. And it was new, and it stayed with us. It introduced a new kind of film. They called it blaxploitation for a while. So it established a new kind of character, established a new genre, and it created a new star. It created Richard Roundtree. I was talking to Mr. Roundtree earlier, and this was, I think he said, the second film that he had done, but it was certainly the first film he'd ever started. So, you know, the first film, he has a major role. He's carrying the film himself, and he carried it off with such, you know, tremendous conviction and aplomb that it made him a star. I went to Wikipedia, because that's what you do to do research this afternoon, and I wanted to count up the number of movies and TV shows that Richard Roundtree has made since 1971, and I gave up. It's really too many, but he's been an active actor in movies, on TV, and also on stage, I found out, ever since then. So. A new kind of character, a new kind of genre, and a new movie star, Richard Roundtree, all came out of this movie. We're showing it tonight because Gordon Parks directed it. The Virginia Film Festival has been really good to cooperate with the Fralin Museum of Art, the University of Virginia's Art Museum. We have a show right now of Gordon Parks photography. Gordon Parks was an amazing man. He was a Renaissance man. He was a photographer, he was a writer, he was a composer, he was a filmmaker. The exhibition at the Fralin, which is open until December, looks at photography that he did very early in his career when he was working for Life magazine. It examines a subject matter that's not too far from Shaft. It looks at the life of a 17-year-old gang leader. Now, when I say gangs, we're not talking about the gangs as we're familiar with today. These were neighborhood gangs. These were juvenile delinquents. The photography is fantastic. And if Shaft launched Richard Roundtree's career, this photo project that he worked on for Life magazine about a Harlem gang leader launched Gordon Parks' career. So I really urge you to take advantage of this free exhibition at the University of Virginia's Fralin Museum of Art and see that. I gave Mr. Roundtree a tour of the exhibition this afternoon, and I was sort of seeing it through his eyes and seeing how cinematic Gordon Parks' photography was even at a very early time in his career. So a lot of interesting things are happening, but I think the most interesting thing will be up on the screen as soon as I stop talking. So please stick around. There'll be a Q&A afterwards with Mr. Roundtree.
Oh, to be young and thin like that again.
So I'm going to abuse my privilege as moderator to tell a little story. This movie came out when I was in high school.
this movie came out when I was in high school, and he loved it. We just had never seen anything like this. And we all, look, I was 16 years old, and we all wanted to be John Chet. We really did. But I knew even then, that no matter how long I lived, I would never, ever, ever be as cool as Richard Roundtree. And here you have the proof. But I do think I want to ask you the first question. As I introduce this occasion by talking about the significance of this movie. But my guess is that when you all, the entire crew, were making this movie, could you possibly have understood what a life this movie would have, how significant it would be, and that, you know, so many years later, we'd still be celebrating?
No concept at all. You got to understand, this was my first feature film. I had a couple of commercials, I'd done a documentary. But to be cast in a major feature film, MGM, I was so green. I can tell you the story behind, prior to the day of actually filming that, blowing you away. I was a kid, and Gordon Parks cast me in this film with MGM. It was monumental. And I was in a daze. From day one until we finished filming. And then I had no idea. You gotta understand something. Here's a guy who's driving a cab to pay for acting lessons at NEC, New Ensemble, in Manhattan. And I'm dropping people off at Sardi's and the Palm Restaurant, and I'm saying, one day. And they announced that they're going to announce the film's start date at Sardi's. And prior to that, I'm hoping about, because Gordon said to me after it was announced that I had the role, he said, but you can't say anything about this because the holiday season, Christmas and New Year's, we won't say anything about this because it'll get lost in the press. We're going to announce it after New Year's. And I'm walking around Manhattan and my comrades are all, you know, hey, you know what, I might have gotten that role. And I can hear this 4 or 5 times. Maybe that wasn't real. Maybe that was a dream. Today, the evening at Sonny's restaurant, walking in there, I can't tell you how exciting that was. Being a cab driver who dropped people off, to walk in there, and I was the center, and they had press from all over the country, because this was major.
Yeah.
A black star in a major MGM film, it was huge. I wasn't aware of how big it was. I'm walking there and all the press are focusing on me. It was huge, you know. It was huge.
I can only imagine. I've got so many questions, but I'm just going to ask two, and I'm going to let the rest of you open them up. But the first thing is, I want to know about the first day of filming. Because you had had small roles, and you had done some modeling, and you'd had some acting lessons, but you were driving a cab. You weren't supporting yourself in acting. And then the biggest thing,
yeah. I did the Great White Hope in Philadelphia.
Okay, on stage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Philadelphia. jobs in commercials or modeling or what have you. And then the evening I'd go back to Philadelphia and do the play. Mm. That was huge.
I can imagine.
James Earl Jones had done this play on Broadway, and I'm doing this play in Society Hill Playhouse in Philadelphia. And I was thrilled. And at one point, I emailed me and said, you know, MGM is doing this film, Shaft. You should go by and give your picture and resume. Sure, he's used to doing that. Let the picture resume and forget it. And call back to meet the casting director. Yeah, I've done that before. Mm-hmm. A couple of days later, I got a call back to come in to meet. To meet Gordon Parks. Gordon Parks? Yeah! Now, I would die.
Gordon Parks was famous at this point. He was a famous man, and he had already made a movie.
Right. Okay.
But to me, more importantly, was I went to high school, competing high school with his son, David Parks. He went to White Plains High School, and I went to Ocean High School. I got it. That's how green I
am. Right.
I get to meet Gordon. And I said, oh, Mr. Barnes, I went to high school. In Georgia High School, where he gets my pain in asthma. I'm going to be son of David.
Seems so fully formed, you know, from top to bottom, 360 degrees, and he's absolutely convincing in that role from beginning to end. And so for me, I'm not an actor, I'm an outsider, and I look at that and I say, well, how is a guy with relatively little acting experience, and certainly not as a leading man in a Hollywood production, how did you develop that character? How did you make it so real?
I did it. Gordon Parks. First of all, I'm not aware of all the perks and whatnot that a star gets. The wardrobe mistress. So did you wear long underwear? And gave me more on the belly. It was cold.
It really was January.
Yes! Put me all on the belly. And I go on. And I got the coat on. And Gordon says to me, he says, listen. Second AD with me down in the subway, giving me the answer.
So I've asked a bunch of questions, but you guys can ask some too. So I don't think we have microphones, but if you shout loudly, we'll hear you. Fuck them on. There are hundreds of you out there.
Not a one. Come on.
Always loved you. Always loved you, Newman, and whatever you played in. Always loved you. My name is Jesse Gatlin. Still out to you. I wish you could shoot another
thing.
Thank you,
Jesse.
Yes, we did. We had a relationship. I was, after that first film, I was, how do I word this? A bit full of myself. And listening to a lot of folks Come on over, I need to talk to you.
Whoa.
And I screamed, said that, the plaza, the apartments, I went up to his place. I understand you're unhappy with your current contract that you signed. That's the part, you know. You gotta understand something. Gordon was so quietly powerful that the studio didn't want Shaft to have a mustache. And Gordon said, he will have a mustache. Look at Gordon Parks. It took me a lot of years to realize.
Can you put your finger on something specific?
Gordon was about right or wrong. There was no gray and had no color. Either you were doing the right thing or you were doing the wrong thing. He didn't look at your paint job. That was the beauty for me. And his choice of weapons.
That was the name of his autobiography.
Yeah. What he chose to fight for, he did it through his camera. And he didn't have to articulate it. But he didn't talk about any of that. He wrote about it. He didn't do his own poetry. He wrote about it in his photography. But he didn't necessarily articulate it verbally.
That's interesting.
He was a consummate genius. I mean, he did. I remember. tell you something. Set up the piano. Started playing this. So you won't remember this, but I wrote that song in the second shift. Don't misunderstand. That is singularly the total history of who John Shaft was. I don't know if you knew the lyrics of that song. Don't misunderstand. We are only strangers. All our way to someplace else. Someplace we forgot. Don't mistake my smile. It just means it. Love me in this place. Forget it. Love me in this place. Oh, I forgot the rest of the lyrics. But it's beautiful.
He wrote the song and the lyrics.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
I saw three questions all at once, and there was one in the middle. I think somebody had a beard, and somebody over here in a dark jacket. So why don't we go to the one in the middle? Somebody had a beard, wanted to ask a question, I think. Is that right about that?
Yeah, you're right. The music fabulous, the Quincy Jones score, unbelievable. The music, Quincy Jones, fabulous. Today's music is fabulous. It really seems like your movements in the movie are coordinated with the fabulous music by Isaac Hayes. Did you get to hear any of that music? Did you really know about it and work with it?
Did I get to work with the music?
Yeah, Isaac Hayes, yeah.
No. I met Isaac post, and hung out with him a little bit. I didn't get to know Isaac until quite a while after the film had been released. And much to my surprise, I was in Memphis a number of years later, and at that point in time he had a radio show, and we're talking, and I'm doing a commercial break. He says, "Tree, you realize that when I signed to do the music for that film, I also signed to do the character Shaft." That's the first I'd ever heard of that. And he said, yeah, I wanted to do that role. Blew me away. Thank the big guy.
Well, he did get his Academy Award.
True.
The best original song. So he did well.
Yes.
He did very well. Wasn't there a question right over here?
Yeah, I wanted, have you had an opportunity to teach young African-American children your craft?
I am not a teacher. Sure is. What I can give, because I've been asked, how do I give back?
Yeah.
I've been
asked, yeah.
And even one of my own children, it's not something I recommend, but if you've been bitten by the bug, there's no turning back. What I recommend is get as much education that you possibly can. Because education gives you options. And when I look at people that I admire, they all have a degree. And just to throw it out, I mean, I look at Samuel L. Jackson, has a degree. Washington has a degree. What education, I already said it, what education does is give you options. I my dream as a young kid coming out of high school with a ranked high school football team nationally.
Undefeated, wasn't it?
Yeah. I did my research. I wanted to be a professional football player. But I learned very early on that I didn't want my mother's oldest son to be hurt like this after the second concussion. There's got to be something else my mother's son can do. And I didn't take advantage of the scholarship. So when I talk to younger people, if you have the opportunity to get an education, and if you have a scholarship, take full advantage of it. And after that, if you, your soul burns to be in the entertainment industry, pursue it at that point. But get that education first. I hope that answers.
It does. Tell me about progress for African Americans in your industry. Any progress that you that you've seen?
Well, when I was coming along, you couldn't dictate. When I look at Sam, I look at Denzel, I look at Fresh Prince,
Will Smith.
We're talking about people who can dictate, put their name on projects that can get produced. It's a different ballgame. So, in the 70s, 2014, the door has opened tremendously. It could be a hell of a lot better. And if you are tenacious enough, you can make a difference. I look at Denzel. He's a monster.
Yeah.
I look at this last film that just came out. That was what Gordon was trying to do back then. Mm-hmm. He has transcended that. It is, he is so bad in this film.
He's scary.
Wonderful. And he can do all of it. He can do action adventure, dramatic, I mean, you know. And I look at how to get away with murder on television. What's her name?
Shonda Rhimes.
Shonda Rhimes, that's the genesis. She's putting stuff on television. Yeah, it's a different ball game. Short answer.
Yeah.
It's a different ball game. Shonda Rhimes is just blown all of the naysayers away.